Please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
I think the Nifty Bank is clearly indicating 0.6 down now on the Nifty Bank. The bigger indices, Sensex Nifty, are down about a third of a percent.
Between now and the elections would be the great time to accumulate stocks and maybe wait for another 3 years to get really good returns on that.
At least for now, it's in the hands of the bears. So the Sensex is down almost 250 points. We have the Nifty, which is down around 0.5%, and the Midcap index, which is flat with a little bit of a negative bias.
On 1st of September, we have to ensure that we have the 3-year TP.
These are still struggling on the back of resurfacing of trade wars. So as we speak, the benchmark indices are down close to about 0.6-0.7%.
Okay. There goes the bell, and the markets ended in a spot of trouble for the bulls. You will have to say 1% gone on the Sensex. I can't remember when last the Sensex lost so much. 106 down on the Nifty and 250 down on the Nifty Bank.
Global headwinds and the Lal Street. The Sensex tumbles almost 400 points. The Nifty sheds a percent. The rupee manages a 6-week high before slipping sharply.
Nifty Bank slides a day after RBI announces hike in repo rate. Kotak Mahindra Bank, PNB and HDFC Bank drag the index.
Even as blue chips slide, mid-caps and small-caps buck the trend. Both indices manage to end the day flat. NBCC, Lemon Tree, Transport Corporation, Dilip Bilcon, Balakrishna Industries were amongst the many which were big gainers.
Pharma stocks perk up in trade as well, with the index gaining a percent. Aviation stocks flying high, with Jet Airways and Interglobe rising thanks to a fall in the crude prices.
FMCG major Marico tumbles almost 5% in trade. This after the company's first quarter margins missed street expectations. Revenues were above what the market expected. Okay, those were the top five stories which defined the day on the Lal Street. It was a bad day for bulls. Hello and welcome to a fresh new edition of Markets Today Talk Back. This is the show where we wrap up the day's trading action in just five stories, five headlines. I'm Prashant Nair. With me is my colleague Anisha Jain. Hi, Anisha.
Hi, Prashant. Thank you so much for that. Well, over the next 30 minutes, we will talk about the top five market stories, and I guess we'll answer your stock queries as well. And joining us today on the show to decode the day's action and answer all your stock queries are market expert Mayuresh Joshi and technical expert Mitesh Thakkar. Thank you, gentlemen, for joining us on the show. But before we come to you, let's take a look at how the markets fared in trade today. Well, Prashant, yesterday was a bit of pause, but today was definitely quite a bit of disappointment for the bulls. Of course, it was partly global, but Nifty gave up 11,300 and Sensex also almost down about a percent, the biggest intraday fall that we've seen in over 4 months now.
But, you know, it was more global, partly global, but there wasn't any other overwhelming reason for the market to sell off like it did. There was company, I mean, Hang Seng, China, but those are markets which get affected directly because that's essentially on the target of US on trade issues, China more so. India, I mean, it's first of all, it's not such a big player in the global trade. And secondly, I mean, all these measures have got nothing to do with India. And I think that kind of differentiated between large cap selling off and the broader market doing quite okay. I mean, you know, came off the highs there as well, but we ended flat. So take a look at the close. The Nifty and the Bank Nifty sharply lower, almost to the day's low. Small cap and mid cap indices flat but higher. Bharti, Maruti, Reliance, Bank of Baroda, Ambuja Cements, Mahindra and Mahindra, the top losers. I mean, actually, all the big stocks from all the big sectors were lower. Pharma, I mean, we read that out as part of the headlines. Lupin, DRL, Aurobindo actually ending the day higher. You know, in terms of broader markets, mid cap, small caps, etc. Some losers, Motherson, Marico results reaction, DLF, Radico, Philips Carbon lost in trade. In terms of gainers, long list. I mean, so it was not all that bad if you looked at the market breadth. It actually was evenly matched by close. So ABFRL, you had Jet, Indigo, Steel Authority, Manappuram, Venkis, Dilip Bilcon, NBCC, Lemon Tree, JM Financial, Balakrishna Industries, just to mention, 10 odd names there. But there were others which were doing very, very well and pretty good. So, I mean, all in all, sharply lower on the large caps, but broader markets faring quite okay.
Oh yes, midcaps were surely the saving grace for the day, but let's go across to a market expert and find out what they make of the markets today. Mayuresh, to you first. Do you think today was a bit of consolidation before we make fresh highs, or do you think that we have peaked out for the year and make the record high already for the year?
So afternoon, Anisha. No, I think since the transpired events of the last few weeks and the expectation of the rhetoric of trade wars, I think it was more global, as Prashant pointed out in today's trade. But a large element in terms of what the governor pointed out yesterday, specifically in terms of inflation numbers, I think that is probably creating some amount of a headwind from an immediate perspective for the market. So yes, I think the cooling down and the consolidation of the markets can continue for the next few weeks, because a large part of the result season is also behind us. But yes, I think any declines in the market becomes good opportunities for getting into good quality names in a staggered way over the longer period of time.
Mitesh, your sense?
Prashant, in the short term, my belief is that today's fall was decisive, and you know, we've had some breakdowns on the indicators, but there was a gap which happened last week around 11,200. So if that is broken, then I think the Nifty would possibly go into some kind of a corrective mode, and we might see possible a proper correction play out in the next few days to come by. In case we hold 11,200, then I think it might be a range of about 11,200 to about 11,400, and this consolidation might last for next about 7 to 8 to 10 sessions.
Okay, so that kind of sort of sets the stage broadly in terms of markets. Let's move on to the second story, the second headline of the day. Nifty Bank, well, it slid a day after RBI announced a 25 basis point hike in the repo rate. Remember, today was also the weekly bank expiry. Kotak Bank, HDFC Bank, Yes Bank were the main culprits. They all were lower. Meanwhile, Nifty PSU Bank Index also saw red. The index was dragged down by stocks like Punjab National Bank and Bank of Baroda. We've got questions coming in, Anisha.
Oh, well, yes. Let's pick up our viewer query then. Ashok Kumar has written to us from Pune with a question on Yes Bank. He holds around 179 shares of the bank at 1,109 rupees a piece for the last 4 years. He's a long-term investor and wants to know if he should continue holding it or selling it. Mitesh, coming to you for this one, it seems like maybe the viewer has bought it before the split that we saw. It should be around 1,800 if you adjust for the split. What do you think he should do? Book profits or continue investing?
I think there was a 5:1 or 10:2 split. I think so the price should be closer to about roughly 220 odd levels. I see no reason to sell for the time being. I think the stock, you know, in fact, in the last many months has been doing this range of about 285 to roughly about 385, 390. I think the consolidation is still on, and you might see eventually a break on the upside beyond 390. I think once that happens, the stock can head towards 450 to about 500 zone. So maintain a positive bias. The stock is just consolidating on the longer term charts, which is totally fine.
We've got another question. Amresh Kumar has written in from Hyderabad with a question on PNB. He's got 980 shares. His cost is 184 rupees a share. Been holding for the last 4 months. He's a short-term investor and wants to know what should he do. Should he hold or sell? Again, Mitesh, what would you tell him?
See, I think the only problem is the acquisition price. So I think, you know, maybe around these levels, in fact, closer to about 70, I think the stock has had multiple bottoms on the long-term chart. One was in May 6, and then in March 2009, and then again in February 2016. I think these are good levels to possibly average it out. I'm not saying that we get a big uptrend over here. I think, but if you buy it around 70, keep a stop below 60 on the fresh quantity, and I think anytime the stock is close to about 110, 15, I think that will be your exit price.
185. I can't see a price of 185 in the last 4 months. Maybe it was a little before that. The big fall happened in February. February, the high was 175 rupees. And before that, in October of 2017, it was at about almost 190 odd rupees or so. So maybe around that is where he got in. But the third headline, Anisha.
Okay, the third headline for the day then. Frontline indices may have wilted amidst startup fears, but mid-caps and small-cap indices managed to buck the trend against a loss of nearly 1% that we saw on the Nifty. The mid-cap and small-cap indices ended flat but higher. NBCC, Lemon Tree, TCI, Dilip Bilcon and Balkrishna were some of the gainers that we had on the index today.
Okay, we've got questions. Rushikesh Thote has written in to us from Pune with a question on Adani Power. He has held 300 shares of Adani Power. His purchase price is 40 rupees a piece. For the last 6 months, he's been holding the shares, sees himself as a long-term investor and wants to know if he should hold or sell. Mayuresh, Adani Power, any hopes?
Not likely in the near future, Prashant. And again, looking at their balance sheet dynamics, I think it's going to be a while till they repair their balance sheet. So to that extent, I think an alternate choice can be something like a capacite infra projects on declines. Very strong order book that the company possesses at this point of time. EBITDA margins at 15%, higher than most of its peers. What they're probably doing in terms of their return ratios because of their execution is reflected on ROEs being at 15, and our own expectations of ROC is actually improving from 15 to 20 odd percent. So on an FY20 basis at EPS of 20, I think there is still sufficient upside left for these stocks from an earnings perspective. So an alternate choice for the investor would be capacite infra projects on declines in a staggered manner.
Okay, that's the word coming in from Mayuresh. So invest in stocks like capacity infra because Adani Power may not come to the levels of 40 in a hurry. But on that note, let's slip into a quick break. But first, let's get some market opinion. Before we do that, our experts will continue to answer all your stock queries back in a jiffy.
Consensus estimates for Nifty earnings is around 600 rupees. Whereas internally, we believe that achieving that would be very, very difficult given the fact that 50% of incremental growth between 19 and 18 was supposed to come from corporate banks and other banking and financial names. We think somewhere around 550 rupees is what we can expect for financial year 19. And even based on that, the markets are quite elevated in terms of valuations. We believe that the next few quarters will be a kind of a consolidation phase. The mid and small cap basket has fallen much more than large cap basket for the last two or three quarters. Maybe we will see some consolidation happening and some bottoming out happening over the next two, three quarters. We really don't expect large returns to come by in the next few quarters. I think whoever is putting in money, and anyways, everyone should be doing that. One should be focusing more on 3 to 5 years at least in equity investments rather than looking at how a calendar year or few quarters are going to pan out. Our view is between now and elections would be the great time to accumulate stocks and maybe wait for another 3 years to get really good returns on that.
Welcome back. Well, let's move on and talk about the fourth headline today. Pharma stocks perked up in trade today. The index was up more than a percent, led by Dr. Reddy's, Lupin, as well as Sun Pharma. Meanwhile, the aviation stocks were also in top form, all thanks to the lower crude prices. Jet Airways and Interglobe Aviation were up more than 4% each.
Okay, we've got questions on both pharma and aviation. Rohit Khandelwal is writing in from Kolkata. He's got a question on Sun Pharma. He's held 20,000 shares of the company. That's a large quantity. His cost is 750 rupees a share. He's a long-term investor, wants to know if he should hold or sell. Cost is 750 on Sun Pharma, and he's a long-term investor. Price right now is 581, 20,000 shares. Mitesh, what would you tell him?
Yeah, I would advise a hold. I think, you know, after a long, long time, there are signs of longer-term charts now possibly setting themselves up for some kind of an upside, especially in stocks like Sun Pharma, Lupin, Aurobindo the Pharma, etc. I think if we can add more, good levels to start accumulating the stock. I don't think now we'll see the stock price dip below 500 anytime soon. And I think the medium-term chart suggests that 730 should be the first target on the upside, while an outside charge of 820, 830 also is there if you give it about a year to about 15 months kind of a time frame. So good buys at these levels, if somebody wants to invest afresh, plus if somebody's holding and has been holding at higher levels, even good levels to accumulate.
Mayuresh, coming to you on this one, Sun Pharma, what's your take on that and the entire pharma space? Do you think all these issues related to US pricing and US FDA issues are behind us? How do you see the pharma sector shaping up now?
So, Anisha, I think to a large extent, I think the issues would be behind us, and even the FDA issues that were hitting their balance sheets with a lot of resolutions coming through, I think both the compliance cost and expectations of their pipeline actually going through in the second half looks very plausible at this point of time. The other element in terms of elevated R&D expenditure that these companies had embarked upon is going to bear fruit because the niche pipeline that they've created will not face so much of a pricing issue as compared to the normal generic drugs. Having said that, for Sun Pharma in particular, I think the management guidance given out and the AI received for its Halol facility, these are positives that should start playing out. But the inflection point will come FY20 onwards. with its complex pipeline actually helping its earnings growth. So yes, I think the investor should probably hold on to this stock.
Okay, and what's your pecking order in pharma, Mayuresh?
So Lupin within the large caps probably stays at the number one slot for us, followed by Sun, Aurobindo Pharma and Ipca Labs.
Okay, the next question is on aviation, but it was also a question about which one, what aviation stock to really go with. Ravindra Kapadia wants to know, he's tweeted in and he essentially wants to know which of the companies, Interglobe, that is Indigo or SpiceJet, should he actually buy? Mitesh, on charts, which one is looking better?
I think if he wants to buy into beaten down sector, none of them are, you know, showing promise on the long-term charts. I would still suggest shift to pharma. Simply as that, I think pharma has already gone through the pain, gone through consolidation at lower levels. So I think I would advise him against getting into aviation stocks. To me, long-term charts of most of these stocks are not showing any signs of promise on the upside.
Okay. Mayuresh?
So very sensitive, and you've seen from Indigo results, Prashant, on ETF prices. And again, the rupee movement, because the translationary effect in terms of a depreciating rupee also hits their P&L pretty hard. Having said that, probably if really one needs to make a choice within this sector, compulsorily and mandatorily, I think SpiceJet probably still looks better among the lot, both in terms of the occupation or the load factors probably remaining very, very strong. And again, I think in terms of what they've probably done in terms of their CASK, ex-fuel, I think that probably remains at optimal levels, and the ASK or the available seat kilometers should probably improve for the industry as a whole, including SpiceJet, with the regional improvements happening. I think that should have a positive effect on that balance sheet dynamics. So pick and choose, I think, SpiceJet.
Okay, so a bit of cautious stance coming on aviation from both the experts, but let's move on and talk about the big last headline of the day. FMCG major Marico tripped almost 5% in trade today. This after company's first quarter margins misread expectations. The net profit came in at 260 crore rupees, while revenue beat estimates to come in at over 2,000 crores. Mangalam Malu has been doing all the number crunching for us, and he's here with all the key highlights.
Well, Marico's first quarter numbers, they look pretty much in line with expectations, barring the cross margins. They declined by about 550 basis points, and that is what led to the miss in the EBITDA as well as the net profit. So run you through the basic numbers. Total revenue growth of 20.5%, a tad bit above expectations of 18-19% out there. A large part of the growth came in from the value growth, and the volume growth came in at 12.5%, which was again pretty much in line with expectations of 11-12%. Management alluded the weakness in their gross margins to a 42% rise in their in the copra prices, which is the core input for them. They maintained their guidance for 8-10% volume growth going forward, and said rural growth is outperforming urban growth for the fourth straight quarter. The stock was at a record high ahead of numbers, which is why we saw that exaggerated cut in today's trading session as well.
Mangalam, thank you very much. Rahul Hamir Merchant has tweeted in with a question on Marico. He wants a long-term view on Marico and wants to know if you should actually buy the stock. I mean, it's not very far away from its life high. So let's quickly get the technical view first. Mitesh, what's your sense?
See, in fact, you know, the stock was doing pretty well and it was making new highs before some kind of correction took in today. My sense is that I think, you know, at least the medium and the short-term charts have been broken with that, and I think the stock might see some more pressure. I think good levels to enter would be closer to about 320, 330 zones. I think if you see the stock around those levels, you might see correction end over there, and then after some base building, the stock can pick up again.
Okay, and Mayuresh, what's your sense on Marico? We have seen the FMCG stocks, whether Jubilant or HUL or Asian Paints, react negatively post the earnings, a bit of profit booking perhaps. What's your call on FMCG and Marico specifically?
Well, the sector as a whole, I think the volume growth numbers on a year-on-year basis looks very glaring because of the low base. Secondly, I think the input cost inflation probably had eaten into their margins. So a lot of FMCG companies had been necessitated to take those price hikes to counter this. And the third element in terms of the rural-urban mix, I think the rural-focused FMCG companies obviously are expecting a huge amount of spurt coming through because of MSPs and normal monsoons aiding volume-led realization growth. So I think for the sector as a whole, we remain very, very selective. For Marico in particular, my own sense in terms of the volumes that they posted and the gross margin deacceleration that we witnessed because of higher copra and curdy prices, though these prices have cooled off, I think the elevated A&P expenses will keep the EBITDA margins in check to between 18-19%. And what probably happens in terms of the parachute volume growth along with Safola, I think that would be key monitorables. From a valuation perspective, mid-40s, so I think the stock needs to correct before the investor can take a plunge into this stock. The alternate that I've got is probably Imami on declines, which probably is a little bit cheaper compared to the others.
Okay, Mayuresh, Mitesh, thanks very much, both of you, for being with us here on the show, answering all your questions and giving us that perspective. Well, from Anisha, me, everyone on the show, thank you very much for staying with us here on another edition of Markets Today Talk Back. Thanks very much for watching.